Tonight we are going to study and discuss from the Bhagavad Gita, chapter 6, text number 13. Ya mam pashyati sarvatra sarvam cha mayi pashyati tasya aham na pranashyami sa cha me na pranashyati yo mam pashyati sarvatra sarvam cha mahi pashyati tasya aham na pranashyami Sacchamena pranashyati Yo mam pashyati sarvatra Sarvam cha mayi pashyati Tasyaham na pranashyami Sacchamena pranashyati Yo mam pashyati sarvatra Sarvam cha mayi pashyati Tasyaham na pranashyami Sacchame na pranashyati Pashyati sees sarvatra everywhere sarvam everything cha and mayi in me pashyati sees tasya for him aham I na not Pranashyami, am lost. Sa, he. Cha, also. Me, to me. Na, nor. Pranashyati, is lost. Translation. For one who sees me everywhere and sees everything in me, I am never lost, nor is he ever lost to me. The following purport was written by His Divine Grace Sri Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada. A person in Krishna consciousness certainly sees Lord Krishna everywhere, and he sees everything in Krishna. Such a person may appear to see all separate manifestations of the material nature, but in each and every instance is conscious of Krishna, knowing that everything is a manifestation of Krishna's energy. Nothing can exist without Krishna, and Krishna is the Lord of everything. This is the basic principle of Krishna consciousness. Krishna consciousness is the development of love of Krishna, a position transcendental even to material liberation. At this stage of Krishna consciousness, beyond self-realization, the devotee becomes one with Krishna, in the sense that Krishna becomes everything for the devotee, and the devotee becomes full in loving Krishna. An intimate relationship between the Lord and the devotee then exists. In that stage, the living entity can never be annihilated, nor is the personality of Godhead ever out of the sight of the devotee. To merge in Krishna is spiritual annihilation. A devotee takes no such risk. It is stated in the Brahma Samhita 5.38, Premanjana Churita Bhakti Vilochanena Santasadeva Ridayeshu Vilokayanti Yamshamasundaram Chintya Gunasvarupam Govindam Adipurusham Tamaham Vachami. I worship the primeval Lord Govinda, who is always seen by the devotee whose eyes are anointed with the pulp of love. He is seen as an eternal form of Shamasundara, situated within the heart of the devotee. At this stage, Lord Krishna never disappears from the sight of the devotee, nor does the devotee ever lose sight of the Lord. In the case of a yogi who sees the Lord as Paramatma within the heart, the same applies. Such a yogi turns into a pure devotee and cannot bear to live for a moment without seeing the Lord within himself. Yomam pashati sarvatra sarvam chamahi pashati tasyaham na pranashyami sacheme na pranashyati. For one who sees me everywhere and sees everything in me, I am never lost, nor is he ever lost to me. Om Jnana Timirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurum Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Mano Bhishtam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Svayam Rupa Kadama Yandadati Svapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yuta Padakamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavancha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Ragunatam Vitantam Sajivam Sadvetam Savadutam Parijana Saitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padam Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakam Vitancha E Krishna Karuna Sindo Dinabando Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gorangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishavano Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Panchakalpatarubhyascha Kripa Sindubhya Evacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadada Sivasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. So this verse, four lines and four philosophical concepts. The first, it says Yomam Pashati Sarvatra, Krishna is everywhere, whoever sees me everywhere. Second, Sarvam Chamahi Pashati, sees everything in me. The third concept we find in this verse is, for him I am never lost. And the fourth concept is, Sachamena Pranashati, is never lost to me. So tonight we are going to discuss these four philosophical concepts. We are going to leave some time for questions. Make question doesn't mean that you don't know the answer. My question means, you know, to give some life to conversation, because I know that you know the whole philosophy more than me even, but you know, today I'm talking, you are listening, so if you can facilitate some question at the end, that will be very nice. So the first concept is the feeling of being lost. There are some people who are fortunate enough to have this feeling from the beginning of their lives. Maybe for karma or some other reason, they have this perception. They look around and they are not really convinced of what they are doing. When we were children, we were looking at our relatives and thinking, who are you? I mean, I don't know you. I don't know, maybe some of you had this perception, some not. Personally, I had. And I don't know you. I'm not sure that I even want to know you, because they were not devotees. I wasn't fortunate enough to have Vaishnava parents. So as a young kid, I was quite confused. Even looking to my house, and it looked like a prison, it looked like a cage. I was limited. I didn't want that. So I was spending a lot of time outside the house with my friends, and they were my society, because they say same age. Whoever has children know that our children, they do not want to stay with us. They want to go out, they want to be with the same age. But still, even with our friends, something was missing. Something was not clear. Nothing really made any sense. There are these kind of people. Maybe they are called existentialists. Not everyone, like we'll see in the second point we are going to discuss. But there are some people who do not make sense of anything. When they become young, they start playing, they have girls, they study, they go to school, and you know, this is just pastime to not suffer too much, but they actually always unhappy. So what's wrong with these people? What do they want? Even if you go to the richest countries of the earth, of the world, you see, the richer the people are, the less satisfied they are. And the reason why is this, is that the poor people, they have the illusion that they suffer because they need money. When I will have money, then I will be happy. So this illusion keep them alive, keep them moving, keep them dynamic. But for those who have everything, they don't even have this illusion. They already have. So why they are suffering? They don't know. Poor people, I suffer because I don't have money. Rich people, I suffer. Why? I don't know why. So we didn't know what we were missing. And now we know. Because from Sri Vrindavan Dham, one person, only one person, came in the West and told us what we are missing. This person is Esi Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, was living here, very close to here, maybe 1 kilometer from here, Radha Damodar Temple. And he came and told us, you are missing Krishna. And we didn't know. I mean, to to know what you are missing and not to be able to reach it, that's one thing. Okay? But do not know, not knowing what you are missing, this is hellish. Because I am missing Krishna, I know where to go to get Krishna. I go to a temple, I go to a guru, I go to Vrindavan. Okay? I know where to go, and at the end I will know what to do. But if you don't know what you are missing, what do you do? Where you go? You can become really crazy over this. You can become mad. That's why the materialists, they are mad, because they feel to be lacking something, but they don't know what, and they don't know where to find it. And Srila Prabhupada, only him came in the West and told us, you are missing Krishna. And this answer, it looks a little rhetorical, because after so many years listening to this answer, to us starts to become a little hazy what it means you are missing Krishna. But after many years of practice, after many years of studying this philosophy, this answer acquires more and more form, meaning we miss Krishna because Krishna is so beautiful, because Krishna is in Vrindavan, because Krishna is with Radharani, because Krishna plays the flute, because Krishna speaks the Bhagavad Gita, because. So this answer at the beginning looked like a way to preach, you know, to cut short what should have been a very long answer. And now it acquires meaning. It gets a form, it gets a substance. We are missing Krishna, and we are missing his form. We are missing his pastimes. We are missing his knowledge. And so like this verse says, we never lose the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So the question is, did we lose him when we were in Maya, before becoming devotee, before coming to Vrindavan? Did we lose Krishna? Actually, no, we never lost Krishna. He's always been with us. We weren't with him, but he always stayed with us. No one said, he never left us. He never abandoned us. He has been very patiently waiting that we changed the priorities for our lives. Krishna was there, looking at, what do you want? You want Maya? I will not abandon you, but you will not see me. I will be hidden from your perception. You'll not be able to understand the reason why you suffer, why you enjoy, why this. You will not have answers. You will have only questions, because you want to enjoy without me. So we had forgotten. We didn't lose Krishna. We had forgotten. So the first concept is Tasyaham na pranashyami Krishna. We never lose him. This is the first concept of this verse. So now we go to the second. The second says, did he abandon us? We already answered partially to this, no? But I want to say something more, because in this world there are not only the people who have this kind of sensitivity. Not everyone asks why I am alive, why I have to die, why I am in this house, I feel like being in a cage, why I look people around me and you know, I don't know who they are, they don't mean anything really to me. Maybe they mean something to me because they give me something, to get something, I will give them something. But not everyone is like this. Most of the people are people like we see here. But Vrindavan is special because you never know who is who in Vrindavan. But let's say outside of Vrindavan, we see the people every morning gets up, every day of every week, of every month, of every year of his life. Have you ever counted how many days, 80 years of life is composed? 28,800 days. Someone who lives 80 years live 28,800 days, and every day people do exactly the same thing. Get up, go to work, for what? Some money to buy enjoyment. When you are old, you have some money in the bank, you buy some enjoyment and you die. You are born to die, you die to be reborn. It's circular. There is no way out. And in the middle, between life and death, is some meaningless sense gratification. Something doesn't mean anything. It's just like when one walks in a desert for years, 1 year walking in the desert, he cannot drink. And someone giving a drop of water. What do you do with a drop of water while you have been walking for so long in a desert? You do nothing. So this is material enjoyment. It's a drop in a desert. It's nothing. Doesn't mean anything. 28,800 days, 80 years of life, and they do exactly the same thing. So have you had, after becoming a devotee, after becoming devotees, have you ever asked yourself if you would be able to do this life? I try to think sometime to put myself, can somebody stop this thing from falling? I don't know why it's falling. Maybe you just, okay. You see, someone really intelligent. I try sometime to put myself to enter into the shoes of people and starting again. Well, not again, because I became a devotee, I was 18. Now I'm 61, so I don't even remember what I was doing before. But I try to think how would I find myself in such a life? Getting up in the morning, go to work, coming back home, family, eating, sleeping, and then day after day. I think this is impossible. This is impossible. Meaningless life. But now, we have a good news for all these materialists, for all these atheists. There is another life. Material life is not the only one. It's not the only life possible. You know, life is not just living. Life means that you do something during your life, your day. The values you give to things, to people. There are other values. There are other ways of seeing people, relating to people. And this is bhakti. This is devotion. And this devotion originated here, right here in Sri Vrindavana Dham, because Krishna took his birth here. And he, in his sense, is representatives. So why does that? Why he sent Srila Prabhupada in the West, and now we have this beautiful temple in Vrindavan, and we have temples all over the world. We have hundreds of thousands of devotees. Millions of people have heard the holy name of Krishna. Why Krishna did that? Well, because Krishna is kind. Because it's the nature of Radha Krishna, means love, means Krishna full of love, and this love becomes a person, Srimati Radharani. Someone who is Srimati Radharani cannot not feel sorry for people who are suffering. This is a natural kindness for someone who is happy. You know, we can see in our lives, if we are happy, we are kind to people. But if we suffer, we get angry. Isn't that? So Krishna, is never angry because he doesn't suffer. And because he never suffers, he's always kind. And because not only is always happy, but he experiments the highest type of happiness. Then when he looks to this material world, he sees these fools trying to live without him, without Radharani, without Govardhan, without Radhakunda, without Vrindavan and everything. He doesn't understand how it is possible that someone lives in that way. So he asks his very dear associates, please go and save these people, give them something meaningful, give bhakti, give Krishna consciousness. So he called our Srila Prabhupada, only he came to save us, nobody else. If it wasn't for him, we were, managers and housewives and I cannot even continue thinking what would have been a life. And he said, go and save these people. Well, he doesn't say, you don't want me, okay, go. He doesn't say that. He says, try to save even those who do not want to be saved. Of course, being saved, nobody can oblige you, nobody can force you. Devotion, bhakti, it comes from the heart. You cannot impose devotion to nobody, but it can be inspired. So Srila Prabhupada was a kind of person that when you saw him, you immediately felt transcendental love for him. It was immediate. He was like a piece of Vrindavan, a piece of Radha Krishna coming to the West, just looking at him. I stayed 7 days with Srila Prabhupada. I can assure you, he was like a bhakti personified. Go and save them. They are my sons. They are forgotten, but they are. I want them saved. And Srila Prabhupada did not spare any kind of effort or austerity. He was 70 years old when he came in the West for us. So I think that dedicating our life to Srila Prabhupada, to his mission, is the least thing we can do. It's just the least. And we don't do more because we don't have more than this. Because our money comes from Krishna, everything comes from... The only thing that we can give Srila Prabhupada is our heart and tell him, okay, I wasted so many lives running after foolishness. Then this life, I will give it to you completely for your mission. And what do you want? If you ask Srila Prabhupada, what do you want from me? Basically, if you boil down all kind of answers, he may give thousands of answers. So many times his disciple asked him, what do you want from me? If you boil everything down, it comes to one thing. Practice and preach Krishna consciousness. This is what he wanted. And I have no doubt whatsoever that this is the only thing that he wants from us. So to conclude, I have the last point, and after we have time for questions. What is bhakti and how to achieve it? Because here the verse is talking about that we had to see Krishna everywhere and in everything. You know, in words, this seems nice and easy, But it isn't easy to understand what it actually means, practically speaking. How can we see Krishna? Do you see Krishna? Maybe you do, I don't. So how can we actually see Krishna even without seeing? So accepting bhakti as your life is a revolutionary approach to life. Rebels, revolutionaries, they don't want to accept anything that they've been told. They want to do something they're convinced. And as I said just a couple of minutes ago, you can force somebody to do many things, to give you money, to do so many things. You can buy everything in this world, but there is one thing that you cannot buy, that is love. Because love, you can fake loving. Someone comes to you and say, love me or I shoot you. You say, okay, I will love you. But is this love? It isn't love, it's fake love, it's false. The real love, it comes naturally. It has to be spontaneous. And this is something that nobody can force. Even Krishna, he can do everything, but he doesn't do it. Why? What love is a love which is forced? I mean, if Krishna put us in our nature the obligatory, mandatory love, that everyone is made love by force, then there is no freedom. It's the most beautiful thing. To love because I choose you to love. It means more. So Krishna likes to exchange love with somebody if the somebody wants to love him. But to be able to want to love him, you also have to be able or not love him. So this is why somebody stays in the spiritual world and somebody comes in the material world. Because somebody chooses. No, I want to stay here and love you. And others say, no, I don't want to love you. I want to try something else. This is freedom. Freedom is so important. Love is made of freedom. So, how can we see Krishna everywhere? First of all, when in this verse Krishna says, we had to see Krishna everywhere. You had to see me everywhere. Doesn't mean only places. It's not only that we had to see Krishna in this place and this house, but also in every moment of our lives. So how do we do this? We know by certain that Krishna is present. Personally or not personally, is present. So the best way, the first way to develop this vision is philosophy. We have to hear philosophy, because philosophy educates our intelligence. It's not just a question of information. I know that you have heard every single word or concept I said tonight. You already heard it. I know that I didn't say one thing that you never heard it. Okay, but why you are still here? Why you are still, you don't get up and say, okay, I already heard it? Because philosophy is not just information, it's education of the intelligence, education of mind. By continuing listening even to the same thing, your intelligence gets formed, gets built up in the same way. Because we are not like Vedic sages that it is enough for us to listen one thing to something that we remember, we realize it, and that's it, we don't need to hear it anymore. We are not like this. We hear, enter into this ear, it comes out, and it remains very little. When we finish the class, all of you, me included, we have been forgotten 99% of what had been said. This is Kali Yuga. There is nothing we can do about. So that's why Srimad Bhagavatam says that we have to regularly hear Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam, not just one time, don't think, oh, I don't go to Bhagavad Gita, I already heard this. I never hear something different. You should go. And by hearing, this thing becomes not only a philosophical concept, but something becomes part of you. You become the philosophy. Immediately, automatically, you see philosophically. It takes time, it takes practice, but go to Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam regularly. But is it enough to hear philosophy? Of course, we know that this information is spiritual. We know that it purifies us, but it is actually not enough, because we need to put, to inject into this concept more spiritual value, more spiritual potency. And this is only present into the Mahamantra Hare Krishna, in the holy name. If we hear philosophy but we don't chant and then the names of Krishna, then the philosophy risks to become a little dry. Concepts, and they purify. I'm not saying that they don't purify, but it is not enough. We need to hear, study philosophy, and chant at the same time. Then all this information gets cleaned. Not that the information were dirty, but our understanding was dirty. We were covering this concept with something impure. So the Mahamantra Hare Krishna cleans our heart, our mind. So philosophy and holy name enters into our mind and heart, and then we become purified. But let's suppose that many, many years go by, we chant and we hear philosophy, and nothing really happens, or very little happens, you know. Or we think, there are many devotees coming to me and say, oh, I've been chanting for 20, 30, 40 years and nothing is happening. But you know, if you are older than him and you remember him the first time that he entered into the temple and see him now, you can see the difference. It's just he cannot perceive. But purification and spiritual advancement is there. You can see it very clearly from the outside. So then what do we do if it appears that it's not really working? Well, this is another good news, that Krishna will help us. And this perception of Krishna helping us is something that everyone can have, but especially those who have been in this process for a very, very long time. Because while something happens to you, you don't understand it on the spot. But when you think about after many years, you said, oh, this is why it happens to me. Oh, this is Krishna doing this. Sometimes Krishna chastises us. Sometimes he gives us a little piece of sugar, you know, because we need it. We are Kali Yuga men. And if Krishna would have said in Bhagavad Gita, the only life possible, I'm just, you know, kidding. Bhagavad Krishna says in Bhagavad, the only way possible doing bhakti is living like Rupa Sanatana Goswami, under the tree and chanting all day 23 hours like Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur. How many of us would have taken this process? Many, many, very few, maybe nobody. So sometimes Krishna chastises us, he knows how to chastise. I tell you, I guarantee you, there are periods of your life where nothing goes right. Everything goes south. Just everything disastrous, you have no money, nobody like you, and you are kicked out of temple. Everything can happen to you. And some other time you get position and everyone likes you, and you become a sannyas, you become a guru, and everyone Maharaj here and there, you know. But then Krishna is always there, and you know it. And as much as he chastised you in the past, and now he's giving something, you have to expect that Krishna may chastise you again. And why Krishna chastised the devotee? Chastise means something go wrong. Why does that? Oh, because we have to understand that we cannot live without Krishna. We cannot think for a moment that everything is okay because I am okay, because I will make everything go okay, because I'm intelligent, because I am lucky, because of this or that. Krishna wants us pure devotees. And when we become pure devotees, without any trace of gross or subtle material attraction, then this is life. This is the happy life that we wanted. So basically this is what I understand from the Bhagavad Gita verse 6:30. We have now 15 minutes of questions. I hope you do have some questions. This is a very nice question because, like most of the questions, Krishna conscious questions, have many possible answers. There is no only I. After many years of being a preacher, the whole of my life, I never really met one question who has only one answer: yes or no. Many depends from the perspective, depends from your realization, depends on what you want to say at the moment. Depending from the capacity of the hearer, or the so many variables. So one thing amongst the many I could say is that not everyone is attracted to Krishna because they like Krishna. Especially for those who have no perception, who have no realization, they do not see Krishna. They hear about Krishna's qualities, but still. It's not really that who attract him. There are so many things in Krishna consciousness that are attractive. Many people are attracted to kirtana. They don't even look to the deities. If I ask all of you what is the color, or rather Krishna dress today, maybe not everyone knows because nobody has looked at them. Or like me, since I have no perception of color, okay, if I turn my eyes from you, I won't even remember the color of your dress because I just don't perceive colors. Okay, so somebody come because they like kirtana. Somebody comes because they like prasadam. Somebody like the devotees. Somebody like the cleanliness of Vaishnava culture, because if you study all religions, there is no, even from the material point of view, there is no another religion. I was born in the capital of Christianism. I was born in Rome, in Italy. So I know it very well. I was brought up as a Christian. And I assure you, there is no religion, even from the material point of view, like Gaudiya Vaishnava. It's so pure, so clean, so profound, so much kindness between devotees, between the whole thing is just beautiful. Okay, so there are so many things. Like, I like to see devotees in dhotis. When I see ladies I find saris very elegant. I like to see ladies when I see them. I'm sorry, I'm not talking about you, but when I see ladies like this, I just like it. I feel it's very nice. And what about the books? And what about the philosophy? for someone who is very intellectual. This philosophy is one who has never read Vedanta Sutra. Oh, you can live the whole life with Vedanta Sutra trying to, and someone who has a philosophical understanding, he finds so much pleasure, so much attractiveness in Vedanta Sutra. And what about Vrindavan? It's such a beautiful place. There's no other place like Vrindavan. Someone who has a material vision sees only pigs and kind of animals. It's not really clean from the material point of view. But most of us, they thank all this. Because if there was not this, Vrindavan was full of sense enjoyers. Okay, now because Vrindavan is not materially so attractive, only those who are very sincere, who have transcendental vision or want to develop transcendental vision will come to Vrindavan, because there is nothing to enjoy here. There is no mall, there is no rock and roll, there is no nothing. You just live very simply. There are temples, Radhe Radhe all the way. So I feel that of course Krishna is very attractive, Krishna means all attractive, but I feel that in our level we can be attracted by so many of Krishna's expansions. Like Srila Prabhupada, we were attracted to Srila Prabhupada. We thought that Srila Prabhupada was wonderful. The first time that I saw Srila Prabhupada was like, I don't know how to describe it actually. You know, it's a moment that I will never forget in my life. It is something emotional, very profound, and this is beautiful. I was attracted to Krishna consciousness also because of Srila Prabhupada. And actually, I remember in 1972, which is my first approach to Krishna consciousness, I was attracted by a newspaper talking about the Hare Krishna movement and the Maha Mantra being sent into radio. Through the radio, I was listening and chanting the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. But the thing that most attracted to me, that it looks sentimental, it may be sentimental, you can think any way you want. But the first time that I really felt attraction was to Srila Prabhupada's face. Because when Srila Prabhupada came in the West, he came in Rome in March 1974, the devotees, they put posters all over the place in Rome. Srila Prabhupada was coming in Rome. I was living 100 meters from the temple. I didn't know that there was a temple. I knew that they are a Krishna, but I wasn't attracted to the devotees. So when I saw Srila Prabhupada, his face, I was so attracted to him. And when I went to the temple for the first time, and I saw that Srila Prabhupada was the guru of the Hare Krishna, then I thought, okay, then the Hare Krishnas, they are okay. So the guru can be very attractive, it's transcendental. So many things.
You have seen Prabhupada, and many of them, they have not seen, just like we have not seen Prabhupada. But through his books and this one, we have seen him, and we love him, we are attracted to him.
Yes, yes. Srila Prabhupada disciple is not a private club, you know, that only Srila Prabhupada disciples can enter. Srila Prabhupada is universal. All of you are Prabhupada disciples through his books, through his instructions, through his being part of ISKCON. We were just lucky, that's all. So sometimes I know the devotees feel like uncomfortable. All these Prabhupada disciples talking about Prabhupada, it seems like they don't. But someone can think, oh, he thinks to be more than me because he's a Prabhupada disciple. I don't think any of Prabhupada disciples think that way, but can be perceived in that way. We were just very lucky, and all of you are Prabhupada disciples.
We respect Prabhupada disciples because they had the association of Prabhupada which we did not have. That's why we like to respect Prabhupada disciples and listen to him more about Prabhupada's Leela and pastime with you.
And we respect you much because you are so advanced that you can even respect someone like me. So I think This is very beautiful, and this is the proof that relationship, transcendental relationships, are not limited in time and space, but everyone can advance just by practicing gurus' instructions.
Thank you very much.
Can you give him the?
If anybody go one step, then 10 steps to the other side.
Another very nice question, actually, very, very nice, because apparently someone can go back, but in actuality, in reality, you don't. The perception of someone falling down from the spiritual path is a perception that we or somebody external to us have to help us recover. But actually, Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita that we never lose what we do. There is actually only one thing very, very dangerous to spiritual advancement. Only one thing. You know, all these things that a devotee falling down for some stupid, you know, smoking or going with somebody like this. Oh, this is nothing. This is just sometime it will be back. But there is one thing you should never do that is offending devotees. If someone loves his son, you know, you can do anything you want to me, but don't touch my son, because I love my son, and love for my son is much more than love for me, because this is how love works. So you can do anything you want to yourself, to Krishna, but don't touch his devotees. Don't touch his devotees. Don't offend the devotees. This is sadhuninda, aparad. Then you still don't lose, but you can be put into hold for very, very, very long time. Very long time. We should learn how to respect everybody. And this is why Vrindavan is so important. Because it's such a train up for, because you have to respect everybody, because according to Shastra, there is no materialist in Vrindavan. If you, even if you see somebody doing something which is nothing to do with Krishna consciousness, they smoke, they do so many things, but Shastra say differently, and you have to accept Shastra, even if it goes against your rationality. So since we are obliged to respect every Vrajavasi, it doesn't matter how fallen he may appear, then this is, there is no place like Vrindavan to be trained up in respecting and loving devotees. Because it's very easy to love and respect a guru, a sannyasi, a very senior devotee. But how can you respect somebody you see with a cigarette? It's very difficult. It takes a lot of effort, internal effort. It's not. The things that help you are not those things who come easily. It's something that you have to make some effort. Just like, I will never forget, one time I went to Varshana, and we as a Western, it's not like you are all Indian, it seems to me. So for you it's very easy, in a sense, to live in Vrindavan, because nobody really approach you asking for money, unless you are evidently some, you know, all these gentlemen may seem like well-being, gentle with money. But Westerners, we are bombarded. Every time we step outside the temple, money, 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 money. So I remember one time we went in for Parikrama in Varshana. At that time, I was very young, maybe 22, like this. That time I wake up, I said, Manonath, don't get angry for one day at least. Don't get upset with Vrajavasis. Don't get upset. Okay, just anything they say or they do, you accept. So we do the whole parikrama. And the way we were doing these things in the 70s was that we were all brahmacharis. So we didn't have any money, But the little money we had, we gave to one person. One person had all the money and spent all the money. We had nothing with us. So I was a little quicker, a little faster than everybody else. I went down the stairs. I just waited for the devotees. And a very old gentleman, evidently very a sadhu, with a white beard and you know the hat, Vaishnava hat and everything, very gently came to me. He said, "Give me some money." And I said in English, "Sorry, I don't have any money." And I tried to explain him. And he spoke English. And he continues, and he said, "No, you give me money." And I said, "I don't have money. I don't have," and I did like this with my kurta. "Look, I don't have any money. Okay, japa, I don't have. You give me money, you give me money." This for 15 minutes, okay? So after 15 minutes, you get angry. You get upset. So I got upset with him. I took it by the arm and I started shaking him, saying, "I don't have it," screaming. So at that moment, my god brothers came and he started to chastise me very heavily. "You promised this morning that you never got upset with Rajava, they are liberated souls." At this point, I got upset with my god brothers also, because they didn't know that I was 15 minutes trying to. So how you keep calmness in all circles? Vrindavan will test you. Vrindavan will heavily test you. And you will see how much not only you have learned philosophy, but how much has become one with you. How much you and philosophy, you and bhakti have become one, the same thing. That you can tolerate not only once, 1 minute or 15 minutes, you can tolerate days someone disturbing you. So to conclude, it seems that you go back, but you don't. I think we have last question and then we have to close. Okay, thank you, Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai.